Welcome back. It's my distinct pleasure and honor to introduce our next speaker, Kanury Rao from New Delhi, India. He's a group leader of immunology at the ICGEB. And Kanury started his career in science as a chemist, but over the past few years, his group has been taking systems level approaches to immunology and immunological immune responses. And in particular, the last few years, he's been focusing on tuberculosis, in particular, how TB interacts with macrophages. And again, taking systems level approaches in really bold and in new ways and really leading the field in this area. He's published a couple of important papers, including just this year. And perhaps the most impressive is a Cell paper where they did an RNAi screen looking for genes that regulate MTB growth inside macrophages. And me and a few other people from CEND were in India earlier this year, and we got to meet not only Kanury, but also his fantastic postdoc, Dhiraj Kumar. And they really blew us away with the description of the screen. And I don't know how much he's going to go into the description of the screen, but basically they chained a bunch of undergraduates to BSL-3 benches and made them pipette, you know, virulent TB. No chains. but it was an impressive display of
bribes.
I see. A carrot, not a stick. Got it. Okay. It was incredibly impressive in its scope and also in their ability to marshal resources and to attack a big question using really big thinking and new ideas and new methodologies. So, Kanury, welcome. And I think today he's going to expand a little bit on the screens and tell us about some new stuff. So I'm really excited to hear the talk.
Thanks, Jeff, and also thanks to Tom and CEND for this invitation to come here and be a part of this wonderful day. And So as Jeff just mentioned, we have recently gotten interested in trying to understand. I mean, the basic question we're asking is, we're interested in understanding is, how does Mycobacterium adapt within the host cell? What are the processes that takes place? And the reason why we are interested in that is we all know. So basically, Mycobacterium targets the host macrophage, and what it does is binds to a variety of receptors on the cell surface and goes enters inside the cell. And basically, once inside the cell, it survives inside the endosomal vesicles, either in the early endosomes or the late endosomes. And perhaps there is a suggestion that some of the mycobacteria may come out, although that's a little debatable, and survive in the cytoplasm. But the point is, once it enters cell, of course, it blocks the phagolysosomal maturation pathway and establishes at least more than one survival niches within the host macrophage. And the point here is that this persistence of survival within the host macrophage is not really a passive process, but actually a very dynamic one, because the macrophage, as we all know, has a variety of potent microbicidal mechanisms that it can activate. And just some of these are listed here: nutrient deprivation, apoptosis, reactive oxygen, and so on. And the survival of the mycobacteria, therefore, depends on its ability to attenuate all of these processes. So in a sense, when you talk about intracellular survival of pathogen, what we're really talking about is a dynamic equilibrium where on the one hand, the macrophage processes dominate, leading to killing of bacteria. And the other extreme, of course, is the mycobacteria completely dominates over host cellular processes and ensures its persistence. The reality, of course, is somewhere in between, where there is always some killing of mycobacteria and some survival, and depending on what the equilibrium is, defined by a variety of host factors and also pathogen-derived factors, the equilibrium is defined. But if you, but the point is, in terms of the dynamic equilibrium, if you look at it in molecular terms, one way of representing it, one way of looking at a host cell, of course, is the protein components that constitute the host cell. And as we know, all of these proteins actually engage in a very complex network of interactions. And it's these interactions that then drive various cellular functions, be it metabolism, transcription, and so on, and so signaling, and so on. So another way of looking at the infection is one that establishes here as an exploitative hub of this network and manipulates functioning of these networks or various functions described by this network through interactions with some of the key proteins that are involved in driving these different functions. So one obvious question that comes up then is that the stable persistence of the bacteria is going to depend on the integrity of these interactions. And therefore, one of the likelihoods that comes up is if you perturb or eliminate any of these interactions, you might then be compromise the ability of the pathogen to survive within the host cell. And if something like that happens, then you also have an additional or an alternative approach to handle the problem of TB therapy. Of course, the problem, one of the issues, of course, is we don't know really much about what are the mechanisms by which mycobacteria establish in the host cell. And more importantly, we really don't know what are the proteins that are involved, the host proteins that are involved in these interactions. So that is really the first job that we set out to fulfill. And this is this is the screen that Jeff just mentioned. Basically, what we did is we took these human THP1 cells and infected them with H37RV, which is a laboratory strain of virulent strain. And subsequent to the infection, we did siRNA knockdowns of all of the host proteins that are coded for and by the human genome, and we used the Thermocon library, which basically had a total number of targets of 18,000 plus. Now, just a couple of points I want to mention here, emphasize here. One is the format of the screen was such that the knockdown was initiated several hours after the cells were infected with the mycobacteria. And the reason for that being we did not want to perturb processes related to the uptake of the mycobacteria, because what we were really interested in is examining that window where the mycobacteria is interacting and establishing that stable equilibrium within the host cell. So that's really the window that we wanted to examine, number one. The other thing is, for a variety of reasons, particularly in terms of robustness of readout, we determined the effects of knockdown on bacterial load by lysing the cells and then plating the bacterial, plating these bacteria and then getting the colony-forming units. And this is the reason why actually it had to be manually done, and that's why the 18 students and et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, so this is the broad format, and this is the results, a summary of the results of the screen. Of course, since we did it manually, we had to make sure that, filter out as much human error as possible. And one of them was actually did a three-layered primary screen, where you first screened with these targets using a relatively low threshold of cutoff. We got these 1,100 odd targets, which gave significant effects. We repeated these, picked up only those that gave identical reproducible results, and then repeated these in a tertiary screen with a higher cutoff and got about 329 primary hits. And then after validation, we used this smart pool of four siRNAs. So the validation involved using each of the single siRNAs per target with the criteria that a minimum of two of those siRNAs should give you a hit. We could finally get about 275 molecules, host factors that were critical for establishing, for maintaining a survival of the intracellular bacteria. Okay. Well, of these 275, 270 were actually critical. That is, when you silence them, there is a severe reduction in the intracellular bacterial load. So this is what we got with the laboratory strain of RV. Now, one of the questions, as we know, like any other pathogen, Mycobacterium tuberculosis also shows a lot of diversity in the field. So you have diversification at the level of genotype, and several different clades are known. In addition, you also have diversification in terms of the virulence properties of the mycobacteria. And finally, of course, as Cliff mentioned in the morning, there is a problem of multiple drug resistant. So one of the questions that comes up is if you, if for the laboratory strain, virulence strain, these are the host factors that seem to be critical for supporting an intracellular infection. So the question that came up is that if you not look at the kind of adaptive variations that you see in the field, what does that translate to at the level of the intracellular interactions? For instance, when the pathogen diversifies, does it also retune or fine-tune the nature of interactions that the pathogen, nature of interactions with the host-specific factors? So that's one of the things, because that's going to be very important when you talk about for drug design discovery and so on, and also from the standpoint of understanding the pathways that are involved. So to do that, what we did is we took a panel of 7 isolates that were obtained from patients in the field by our clinical collaborators. And these are the 7 isolates that, okay. Now, the interesting about these 7 isolates, they derive from 4 different clades of the virus, of mycobacteria. In addition, these are the standard frontline drugs, and plus simply means resistant. And as you can see, these 4 strains are resistant to a single drug, but each one a different one. And these 3 are multiple drug resistant in the sense because they're resistant to 3 of the 4. But again, the resistant profile is unique in that they don't overlap. And if you look at growth properties of these strains inside the THP1 cells, they're quite dramatic, they're quite variable. And some people have suggested that growth rates within the host cell may actually reflect the virulence properties. But be that as it may, nonetheless, these 7 strains actually give you a kind of a window or encapsulate the level of variation that you see in the field at the level in terms of the genotype, in terms of drug sensitivity profiles, and also in terms of at least growth rates, which may or may not relate to the virulence properties. So what we did is we went back and infected the THP1 cells with each of these 7 strains, and then silenced, screened against those 275 host factors that we had identified against the H37RV or the laboratory strain. So this simply cuts, just presents the results in the form of a heat map. And the obvious thing that stands out is that the efficacy of these 275 knockdowns was unique, was different from each of these strains. So suggesting that these strains showed a lot of divergence in terms of the extent of dependence on each of these host factors, right? So that was somewhat of a surprise, showing because there was quite dramatic differences, say between any 2 strains in terms of their level of dependency on these host factors. And if you do a clustering analysis, one of the primary distinctions factors that drives this distinction appears to be the clade of the pathogen, and of course presumably other properties such as growth rate and so on may also contribute. But at the same time, if you now classify the hits that you get against each of these into different functional classes, such as cell cycle and intracellular trafficking, migration, this is metabolism, and so on, and then look at how the hits that you get for any of these strains, how they are distributed across these different classes. Interestingly, it turns out that although the number and nature of hits you get can be different, but the distribution across these functional classes stays a constant. And what that suggests is that the spectrum of cellular function that the mycobacteria needs to manipulate stays a constant. What varies with these field variants is the manner in which they achieve it, or more precisely, the proteins that are involved in each of these functions, the ones that are, which are these that the mycobacteria target? So that seems to vary. But in terms of the nature of cellular functions that are involved, it seems to represent a constant requirement for mycobacteria. Another interesting finding was, although we got this kind of variations, we could nonetheless get 74 host factors that were invariant across all of these strains. And what I mean by invariant is, if you knock any of these down, intracellular survival of all of these strains, 7 plus 1 H strains, is severely compromised. So suggesting that at least these factors are obligatory requirements for optimal mycobacterial survival, regardless of at least the properties or spectrum of properties that we examined with this panel. So if one were to go for exploit these in terms of drug target, this is the list that one would focus on. And I'll come back to that a little later. This is simply, again, this is published, so I won't spend too much time on that. I just put this to emphasize that what we could also find is that of the 74 factors that we identified, 44 of those appeared to function as novel regulators of this process called autophagy. Right? So it turns out that the dominant mechanism for clearance, at least in the context of the hits that we identified, involved the process of autophagy. And as you all know, autophagy was originally discovered as a stress, a nutrient stress response, where nutrient-deprived cells suddenly start forming membranous vesicles in the cytoplasm and drag old protein complexes and other such bodies to the lysosome for degradation, and that degradation then provides a pathway for rescuing some energy for the nutrient-deprived cells. And of course, subsequently, that autophagy has become a big issue and has been implicated in a whole range of diseases, including diabetes, cancer, and so on. And importantly, autophagy has also been shown to have the ability to clear intracellular infections. And at least from what we find is that of these 74 molecules, 44, so what these 44 molecules seem to represent are novel regulators, because their role in autophagy has not been anticipated. And it turns out that all of these are negative regulators of autophagy. And what Mycobacterium does is exploit them, somehow control them, and use them in order to block the activation of autophagy by the infected macrophage, as I show you. So what happens if you take an infected cell, and if you knock any of these down, and one way of probing for the activation of autophagy is through the induction of this protein called LC3-2 or LC3-B. And you can see that, in all of these cases, you see induction of LC3B, although in some cases band intensities are weak, and that is not because there are quantitative differences, but actually there are kinetic differences. Some of these are induced very early, within 6 to 8 hours after the knockdown. Some of these take a little longer, and that's why these are all single time points, so that's why some of these bands are weak. So, and this is something we are following up, and we have now the complete kinetic profiles for activation of at least LC3-2 upregulation in response to all of these knockdowns. So that seems to be one important pathway. And interestingly, it turns out, subsequently what we have found is that the ability to suppress autophagy, in fact, constitutes one of the key correlates of the virulence properties of the mycobacteria. So, and what I mean is, if you infect THP1 cells or even normal human macrophages, primary human macrophages, with an avirulent strain of mycobacteria, which is H37RV, and the moment the cells are infected, you can see there's a strong induction of LC3B. And interestingly, if you now add rapamycin, which is the classical activator of autophagy, you do not see any further induction, suggesting that this infection alone activates autophagy to near saturable levels. On the other hand, if you infect with the virulent strain of mycobacteria, you do not actually see any activation of autophagy, but you can induce it now through the activation of rapamycin. And this is again supported by this confocal microscopy experiment, where if you take fluorescently labeled bacteria and look at infected cells, you can see the induction of LC3B or LC3-2. And if you now merge, you can see most of the mycobacteria is actually co-localized with LC3-2, suggesting that in this situation, the majority of mycobacteria are headed for elimination through degradation. On the other hand, if you now look at RV-infected cells, there isn't much any LC3 induction, and most of the mycobacteria are free of autophagosomal occupancy. And this shows it at a little more detail, and I'm just showing this to make the point that the when you talk about virulence or non-virulence, the broad theme that emerges is the ability to suppress autophagy is at least one of the parameters that defines the endpoint of that equilibrium between survival of bacteria on one hand and its elimination on the other. And this just in a very simple way illustrates the same thing. So this again is the HP1 cells infected with H37RA. These are the lysosomal compartment labeled isotracker. This is LC32. And if you look at it, almost all of the mycobacteria that you see are actually co-localized either with lysosomes or autophagosomes or both. And on the other hand, if you look at RV-infected cells, although there is some killing that, as you can see, because of co-localization LC32 or lysosomes, there are nonetheless a fair amount of free mycobacteria. So if you just compare these two, you're actually looking at a shift in equilibrium from one extreme to somewhere closer to the center or right of center, and defining the differences in proportion of mycobacterial survival, which correlates with the ability to suppress autophagy as a trait that reflects the virulence properties of the mycobacterium. So since we had these 44 molecules, and none of them were known to play a role in autophagy, obviously we wanted to find out how do they link to, what are the possible pathways through which they might regulate autophagy. So what we did at one level, this of course was for many some other reasons too, is that we took the 275 hits that we had originally identified, and then also using standard string databases and other such databases, we also identified what its immediate interacting partners were, and then collectively extracted the network that both that the hits and their immediate first interacting partners form. And this is the kind of network that you get, and we call it the MTB regulatory network. This simply tells you that the network that you get is a good one, which has all the properties of a good network in terms of clustering coefficient, node degree, scale-free organization, etc. What we interpret this network to represent is the molecular interface that the host cell provides for engagement by pathogen, right? And once you get this network, what we then did is looked for two things. Where was mTOR, which is one of the key regulators of autophagy, and then looked for in relation with mTOR, where are the 44 molecules that we identified as part of a screen for all this, as being regulators of autophagy. It turns out that we could, obviously, you need to put some kind of a cutoff as to the distance that you would accept as being relevant. So we used a cutoff of about a path length of 4. That is, it is separated at the maximum by 4 steps. And this is the kind of network you can extract from this. This is mTOR. And these are the immediate interactors or immediate regulators of mTOR. And this circle is the set of molecules that regulate the regulators of mTOR. These regulate regulators of regulators and so on. And these larger diamonds are those that were part of the hits that we got. And out of the 44, we could identify 18 to be present within this step of 4 from mTOR or FRAP1, right? And this tells you something interesting, although we still have a lot of work to do on this to define it. What is particularly interesting is none of these molecules actually directly regulate mTOR. They're all indirect regulators. About 8 or 9 of these are here, which regulate regulators of mTOR. And these are a little more distal, and of course, this one is furthermore separated. Now, this, I think, we think has interesting implications, because one of the advantages of indirect regulation through intermediates is that you can actually employ complex modes of regulation. Direct regulation sometimes doesn't give you the level of plasticity that indirect regulation can give you. It's much like rumors. I mean, you can create havoc by adding the number of steps between you and in terms of transmitting information. So that allows more plasticity and more fine-tuning, and we presume so this kind of a distilled regulation also makes it more difficult for us to rationalize and to understand what are the mechanisms by which mycobacteria control at least one of the mediators of the autophagic pathways. Now, another interesting finding that was made by a group recently looking at hepatocytes in terms of autophagy is what they discovered was that autophagy, basal autophagy, because all cells, even in the absence of any stress, show low levels of autophagy, and this is called basal autophagy. And what they showed is that basal autophagy actually is very important for turnover of lipids, particularly triglycerides and cholesterol esters. So it actually maintains homeostasis of these lipid triglycerides and so on inside the cell. And conversely, if for whatever reason, if there is an accumulation of lipids in the host cell, you actually see inhibition of the autophagic pathways. Okay? So what this suggests is that there is this regulatory link between lipid turnover and autophagy, so that autophagy, while autophagy is responsible for homeostasis of lipids, accumulation of lipids can have attenuating effects on autophagy. And this could have very important implications for Mycobacterium infections, because as we all know again, that when macrophages are infected by mycobacteria, eventually they develop this phenotype called foamy macrophages. And what foamy macrophages essentially are those where you see an accumulation of a lot of lipid droplets. And eventually the mycobacteria fuses and is engulfed by those lipid droplets. So at one level, this lipid environment provides a very steady source of nutrients. And on the other hand, this lipid coat also buffers the mycobacteria against all the assaults, microbicidal assaults of the macrophage. And interestingly, what we find is that the extent of lipid droplet formation is again a property that correlates with the virulence of mycobacteria. So if you infect these cells with an avirulent strain, you do see some lipid droplet formation, which are these orange stains, but certainly nowhere as extensive or as intense as when you infect them with the virulent strain. So again, perturbation in lipid metabolism seems to correlate well with the virulence properties of the mycobacteria, and this goes hand in hand with what I showed you earlier, is the ability to inhibit autophagy also goes well hand in hand with the virulence properties of the mycobacteria. So clearly, there is some kind of a mechanistic link between these two, and we think exploring this mechanistic link would be one of the keys to understanding how mycobacteria adapts within the host cell. So really, one of the key would be to understanding the regulatory link between lipid metabolism and autophagy in principle, and how this is perturbed by mycobacterial infections. And the important thing about this particular link is that it is also incorporates or integrates a variety of extraneous factors, which in terms of the host-specific factors, such as genetic, epigenetic, and so on, or on the other hand, properties derived from the mycobacteria, such as virulence and so on. So this axis could actually be sensitized to context of the infection, and eventually perhaps may explain why some individuals are more susceptible than others, and so on. These different individual-specific differences that we see in terms of the outcome of the infection. But that's a long way off, and right now one of the key efforts in our lab is to understand the cellular pathways that regulate autophagy, because again, autophagy is a sensing mechanism that responds to both cellular cues and environmental cues. So there's a broad network of pathways that regulates autophagy, and also it's balancing out with the lipid metabolism system. This is a challenging task, but fortunately, a few months ago, there was a paper from Wade Harbour's group from Harvard Medical School. And what they had done is done the first network characterization of basal autophagy. And this was basically a proteomics-based study where they took some of the known key intermediates involved in the autophagic pathway and looked at the other proteins that they interact with and so on, and then built this basal autophagy network. And the network that they got basically consists of about 400-odd proteins with so many interactions. And of course, these proteins came from diverse functional classes, including trafficking, cell signaling, ubiquitination, metabolism, and so on. So that is something that you would expect, because again, autophagy is a core sensing mechanism that senses stresses and other kinds of cues, both from an extracellular and an intracellular environments. So since we had this network, we thought, okay, let's allows us for a first level analysis in terms of from the standpoint of looking at the effects of mycobacteria. So what we did is we basically either took infected cells with, you know, with RA or RV, and at different time points, these are all in hours, we looked at the, we performed a microarray analysis for all the host genes that are induced at these various times after infection, number one. And then by comparing the profiles, we could extract those genes that were differentially regulated in RV infected cells as opposed to those infected by RA. Because the point by, of this kind of subtraction was that you can now filter out those gene expression events that are that are relevant to the virulence properties of the mycobacteria. So we could get about 300 odd genes that were fell in this category. And surprisingly, of these 300, 200 were components of this basal autophagy network. And this suggests that the kind of effort that the mycobacteria, the virulent mycobacteria, exerts in terms of ensuring that it maintains a very tight control over the autophagic pathways. And that is even more evident when you look at, so this is simply the same basal autophagy network I showed earlier in put in a different view. And what these red circles are the ones, are those 200 genes that are differentially perturbed in RA infection, in the RV infection. And the larger circles tell you of these, you know, the hits that we had as, among the 44, which they are, you know, of those 200 genes, many of those included these about 22 or so list from a 44 protein, and those are what you can also see here. So what is obvious without going into details is that the genes perturbed by or influenced by our virulence-specific infection are actually present at all across the topology of the network, suggesting and you know that it really has a comprehensive control over the pathways, over the autophagic pathways, and more important that this kind of effort effects. A control appear to be nonlinear and therefore are going to be extremely difficult to understand. And just to prove that point, I've extracted a small module from that network, and that module is centered on this molecule PRKAG2, which is the regulatory subunit of the AMP dependent kinase. I can't see it from here. Okay, so these are the other subunits of the kinase, and this is a very small module, as you can see, with just the first interactors. But even in the small module, you see diverse protein, diverse activities being incorporated, like protein translation. These are nucleotide synthesis regulators, glycolysis enzymes, and so on. But what is more important is the expression profiles of each of these genes that are in RV-infected cells. Red is upregulated, green is downregulated. And you can see each component of this module is actually perturbed by the infection. And in a very complex, I mean, collectively, it's a very complex pattern that you get because it's nonlinear in many instances and kinetic with different kinetics and so on. So it's really going to be challenging. And our goal actually is to look at this in a more quantitative sense and perhaps use differential equation-based modeling to look at these processes. And that's not going to be an easy job. But the point I just want just to emphasize here is that, you know, so Michael, one of the, you know, so is the very complex mechanisms that seem to be involved in terms of mycobacterial regulation or control of our autophagic pathways. So, and one of the grand challenges really would be if we can actually map the topology of all of those interactions that converge onto regulation of this core axis. And so this, in general, most communication networks, including signaling networks, seem to have what you can call this bow tie or hourglass architecture. And the, such a structure is essential because in general you have all of these molecules here which sense perturbations in environment, if you're talking about a signaling network, for instance. And they communicate that to a core processing module which then processes the information and then executes it through downstream mediators at the level of the cellular response, which usually is the genes that are going to be expressed and so on. So What we think in terms of the mycobacterial adaptation in the host cell also involves such a bow tie architecture. And these upstream would be the receptors through which it enters the cell and a variety of other perturbations in metabolic pathways and signaling pathways. And we think that this core of in a sense, what this translates as the lipid metabolism autophagy module is one of the keys that regulates the outcome in terms of on the one extreme of killing or persistence or replication and so on. So it really would be great if one could chart that. It's not something that just any one lab can do. It's going to take more like a consortium effort, but this would really be the ultimate challenge in terms of understanding the mechanism by which a pathogen adapts inside the host cell. Of course, the other point for starting this kind of investigation was, if you identified some of the key host factors that mycobacterium requires for intracellular survival, can such factors become targets for drug therapy? And this is a work in progress. But I'm just going to show you a couple of slides quickly, just to say, yes, of course, this is an alternate approach to go. And perhaps in many ways, it's an approach that shows an enormous amount of promise and potential. And the reason I say that, okay, so just broadly speaking, what we're doing right now is from those targets that we had identified, we are now focusing on chemical inhibitors against four of those. And the reason we are looking at these four inhibitors is because these are already in the market, have cleared clinical trials. So it's really a repurposing strategy. And if they work, one could quickly go to the subsequent stages of evaluation. And the good thing is all of these, so the kind of assay systems we're using to evaluate them, one, of course, is reduction in intracellular load, both in THP1 cells and primary human macrophages, derived from a whole spectrum of individuals, so that you're also accounting for differences in HLA type. And we test that by two ways. One is you can take GFP-labeled mycobacteria, treat them with the inhibitor that we're examining, look for clearance, and of course, in parallel, we also do reduction in terms of determining the colony-forming counts. We are also examining the effects of these inhibitors on the accumulation of lipid droplets in infected macrophages. And this just shows you in these inhibitors what happens is that once you treat with inhibitors, you actually see a dispersion of lipid droplets into much smaller molecules. So that's one of the other exigency. The third kind of assay system is what we are using is the one developed by Fred Alter, which is basically an in vitro granuloma assay. So basically, the assay is if you take primary human PBMCs and infect at very low MOIs, over a period of week to 2 weeks, you'll start seeing these aggregate structures, which include multinucleated macrophages, giant cells, epithelioid cells, and a lot of recruited T cells. And these seem to have at least some of the features that characterize granulomas. And so we are also using such systems to look at the efficacy in terms of reducing the burden. And the other important thing is, we use a panel of MTB strains to test this. And this includes, of course, H37RV. We are using 3 MDR MTB strains. In fact, now we are using more. And we are also using a couple of XDR MTB strains, which we got again from the field. And the good news is that in all of these cases, these inhibitors work extremely well. And at least in these assays, the IC50 ranges from 5 to 50 nanomolar. And what to us at least is unique in this strategy is that the IC50 is insensitive to whether the strain is drug sensitive or multiple drug resistant or extreme drug resistant. And I'll just show you results for a couple of these in the mouse model. So these also work in the mouse model. And what I'm showing you is experiments in the BALB-C mice where you can actually infect mice with, so these are normal mice infected with H37RV. This is in Tibet knockouts, but I won't discuss this at the moment unless somebody has a question. And if you now treat them, and we're using inhibitors against two different targets in these studies. So if you use inhibitor against one of the targets, you do see a decrease in mycobacterial load, the infection load. The inhibitor against the other target also suppresses partially. But if you now combine the two, you actually get a clearance of infection. And this works well if you start treatment at the early stage of infection or at a more later stage of infection where the infection load is high. In both cases, when you combine with the combination of both inhibitors, you can actually clear the infection. What is particularly remarkable here is that this particular experiment essentially is the same as this, except there are different strains of MTB, and these are all MDR strains with different resistance profiles, and this particular strain is actually XDR strain. Yeah? And in all of these cases, as you can see, if you combine the inhibitors, you can actually clear the infection, and again in the earlier or later stages of infection. So targeting the host gives you an effective way of treating in a manner that does not really care whether you're looking at a drug sensitive or a drug resistant strain of bacteria. The other possibility that we considered was we know that what these inhibitors do is at least one of the modes of action is activate the process of autophagy. So what happens in autophagy? The bug is essentially dragged eventually into the lysosomes and degraded in the lysosomes, right? So what happens once it's degraded in the lysosomes, we considered the possibility that following degradation, peptides derived from these mycobacteria are likely to be presented on the surface of these macrophages, and that could in turn activate the immune system and produce an immune response. And then there are also therefore chances that this immune response may in fact be protective against a subsequent round of infection. And we tested that, and that indeed seems to be true. Although this is preliminary data, I wouldn't really jump and shout about it, but just that it looks promising. We have a lot more work to do. These are mice infected with H37RV, so there's a parallel set you drug treat, and they clear the infection at least to this level of sensitivity, and if you now re-challenge, they do not take up infection, at least within this window of time. We still have to see what happens at later time points, and as Cliff was mentioning in the morning, in terms of relapse and all of those things. So a lot of work needs to be done, but also important is, again, if you take mice infected with the MDR or the XDR strains of pathogen and treat them, and now when you re-challenge, again, they're resistant, at least again within this short time frame. So this seems to be another potential advantage of this approach. So not only can you clear in the context of just the mouse model that I'm showing you, obviously there's a lot more that needs to be done, but not only can you clean up the infection to whatever extent that we see, but in the process, if these results hold true, then it's likely that in this process you can also induce immune memory against a subsequent exposure to the infection. And as I said, many other issues we need to look at. For instance, what is the duration of this immunity? Are we really looking at a memory response or a primary immune response that is protecting, and so on? But nonetheless, it tells you that the approach of targeting host gives you an alternate strategy. And there are other ways you can think of applying it, which we need to start exploring. Is, I think, again, Cliff mentioned in the morning, one of the problems of why drug resistance emerges is the long duration of treatment that we have with the combination of four drugs, which is over 6 to 8 months. So it really would be interesting for us to see, and this is something we're going to initiate very soon, is that if you take those four drug regimen and combine it with some of these drugs against the host target, can you now shorten the window of treatment? And if you can do that, that again would be a huge plus in terms of at least reducing the evolution, the emergence or the future emergence of drug resistant. So this is really where we are. And I need to thank all the guys who actually do the work. And all of this work was done, again, in collaboration with my colleague who Jeff mentioned, with Dheeraj. We did the screen together, the analysis together, and so on. These are some of the students in my group who have, these guys did the mouse screen, which I didn't talk about. Faisal did a lot of proteomics. A lot of the drug studies I showed you is done by my graduate student, Vashne. And a lot of the work on the autophagy and all are by students in Dheeraj's group, Swati and Pallavi and so on. The animal experimentations in collaboration with my immunologist colleague in my group, Govardhan, and his postdoc, Tanmay. This is the institute I come from, and all of this was funded by the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. Thank you so much.
drug that, or the inhibitor that prevented the growth in vivo?
Oh, these are actually, I guess, four of those targets. These are with the pharma companies, so I apologize. But you're talking about LOS2 inhibitors.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're actually against a couple of receptors, GPCRs and so on. Yeah. Yeah, both of them do, yeah, yeah.
So what about rapamycin?
Rapamycin will clear it, yes, definitely, yeah. In fact, I showed the slide, I didn't discuss it, yeah.
Kanury.
Yeah.
Beautiful work. I wanted to ask you a question about the model of infection for mycobacteria. So since you have so many of these autophagy genes involved in there, and I sort of remember there was a study in which mycobacterium was shown to emerge into the cytosol a little while ago. So I'm wondering, is it possible that when the bacteria are taken up by the macrophages, they actually have a phase in the cytosol where they then get taken up by the autophagy mechanism and then delivered to the lysosomes?
Yeah, actually the problem is there, a lot of debate. There are some people who say, yes, it goes cytosol. Some people say it's crazy, it cannot go to the cytosol. I don't know what Jeff or Cliff believe, because I leave it to them. I honestly don't have an opinion. This was there in the literature, so I'm not sure. Tom, you have an opinion on that. Your question is right, but again, it's not clear. Does it stay, or is it just dead mycobacteria, or I don't know.
So that would be a really spectacular example of treating the host to go after a pathogen. Does the re-challenge, is it species specific?
No.
So.
But what we don't know is the duration.
If you treat with another intracellular pathogen, that's also not taken up.
No, I'm sorry, I didn't get.
So. Do you have to re-challenge with the same strain of TB or even TB?
So, when I said no, you can re-challenge any of these with RV, for instance. I can take XDR infected, treat it, and then re-challenge with RV, it's protected. Now, what is the level of diversity that is tolerated, we don't know yet.
But could you re-challenge with Legionella or Listeria or something else? Another bacterial species.
Oh, another bacterial species, that we haven't done, no. That we need to do, yeah.
Could you mention what the cytotoxicities were of those drugs that targeted the host factors? Could you mention what the cytotoxicities were of the drugs that targeted host factors?
This is against the host cell? They're not toxic against the host cell, no. In fact, two of them are already in use for other indications in the market. So I did show the data, but they do not target the host cell. They also do not target bacteria when you grow them in cell-free cultures. So they only target bacteria in the context of the infected cell. So they're not antibacterial also.
Do you see polymorphisms in these genes?
Yeah, that's a good question. That's something at a population level we need to look at that. We haven't started that, but that's something it's a very good point, actually. So we're linking up with some human geneticists in Calcutta to start that.